Dr. Mutsert, and his talk is going to be on MR image analysis in brain imaging. Thanks.
Yes, okay, thank you very much for your kind introduction. I will, from the spirit of this workshop, I would like to look at the image processing of brain MRI from the reproducibility perspective. And I'm also going to concern physiological MRI, which is arterial spin labeling perfusion MRI, which is the most of our work. And I have nothing to disclose. And the reason, as I will show you, that I will focus also on arterial spin labeling is that there is a, I believe, a large correlation, or there can be, between pathophysiology and your image quality. So I think that's one of the main take-home messages of my talk. The other one is that you should, and I think a lot of people do that, but I think we can always improve, have visually and quantitatively QC, use your common sense, go through each image processing step and look how this can affect your reproducibility and comparability of your results with other studies. So why do we want a reproducible imaging biomarker, as you can call it? Well, you can do a couple of things, not only to study neuro function and structure, et cetera, but also a secondary prevention, early diagnosis, and also pharmacological studies. It's interesting to have similar image processing, and that we can actually compare our academic studies with pharmacological studies, where it's important to develop new biomarkers for treatment and see how the treatment is doing. And a good image biomarker would tell you the same contrast as you see here, between physiological and pathophysiological, or maybe accelerated aging. And this is, from the dementia context, a very well-known diagram, or sort of a way to visualize how Alzheimer or other types of dementia would develop. And before you can, as a doctor in your outpatient clinic, clearly see that somebody has outblown dementia, you would see some imaging biomarkers already change. And the idea is that we can find image biomarkers that change earlier than large structural changes. And that's where arterial spin labeling, perfusion imaging, but also DTI, fMRI, and a lot of other MRI and other biomarkers are developed for. And what I like to actually emphasize is that a lot of reproducibility checks are done in healthy controls. And that's not only for the acquisition side, but also I think in the development of image processing, we should look at what is the effect that the physiology or pathophysiology has on your image processing. Very briefly, how arterial spin labeling perfusion MRI works, because I won't go into depth here. What we do other than with a normal MRI image is that we label, and that's labeling is called, is a word to announce the inversion of your magnetization. Here in a plane proximal to where we will take our picture and make a image. And we do this in the only, we do this with the spins, and spins is MRI jargon for water protons, and the only ones that will flow up and where you can take an image later that will give you perfusion is in the arteries. So that's why it's called arterial spin labeling. And so we magnetically inverse the only in this plane, and we wait for a certain delay to allow these arterial spins to flow to the brain, and then we can create an image which will be presentable to how much blood has traversed or perfused 100 grams of brain tissue each minute. And we have a very large and nice pipeline to do this in a sort of standardized way. And I won't discuss all of these steps with you, but there's a few layers in the processing, a few modules that you should understand, of course, from the ASL perspective. This slice is advanced automatically. From the ASL perspective, this is obviously the most important module, but actually a lot of work goes one step before in the structural module, because the ROI definition, where is my signal, and also the registration to compare with other patients, completely depends on your structural module. So that's very important also for many other advanced MRI biomarkers. And then there is a population module where you will, on a population basis, compare different subjects, images, and can do quality control on a population basis, which we do in MNI. So you can also make normalized and mean images from all the subjects. But before we do that, there's a whole bunch going on here, which you can call research data management, which I think we should focus on more. There's a lot of talks in this meeting already in the past days about XNet bits and how you should do this. So I will not focus on this, but I will focus on quality control and defacing. So let's start with quality control. There are multiple levels of quality control on the scanner already or in the patient, and we are focusing on the quality control of the raw images and of the image processing. A part of Explore-ASL called Explore-QC, developed by a PhD student of us, has been focusing on this in a large multi-site pre-Alzheimer study. And there are basically two extremes how you can do your QC. You can do it visually. That takes a lot of time, but it's, of course, sort of gold standard. But it can be subjective. And then there are people that are developing automatic QC, for example, in the UK Biobank, which has only a single type of Siemens MRI scanner. You can do this with machine learning and you can automate this to a large extent. But this can be difficult if you have multiple image types and if you have multiple scanners. So we decide to do a sort of in between so that you look at your image features and then you can sort of look at their outliers and then you will visually confirm that. And so while I think we should go to an automatic QC, there's a lot that we need to improve here. So we did it in this way. We took a lot of image features, which can be motion, can be noise, can be the bias field. You can look at the asymmetry. You can look at actually the post-processing, for example, this case, volumetrics or perfusion or other biomarker descriptives. And what you can do is you can sort them over each site. So here you see multiple sites of this large multiple center study together, coded with a number. So the x-axis has no other meaning here. And here in the y-axis, you see the SNR of the gray matter from their T1. You see that it obviously differs quite a bit between sites. And if you look within one site, in this case, site 31, you could, in this Explore QC, you could click on a certain outlier and you could look at it. And here you see that the differences are not too large, but you can see that there's a little bit head motion here. So this is just to show that you should actually look at what in your study, what is the best way to do QC. And this is very important because if you go, for example, to an UTNI study from the US, which is a multi-site study with a lot of people, then if you look at the publications, then everybody did this type of QC in a different way. So everyone includes just slightly different subpart of the whole study, which can give you different results. And so it's important to do QC in a standardized way. And this is just to show how your QC parameters here in the y-axis differ between sites, but also correlate with age and sex. And even, which is not shown here, they correlate with pathophysiological biomarkers and other clinical parameters. So it's always good to look, are we not excluding the worst quality, which are actually our most interesting patients? Okay, to go on to the defacing, for privacy laws, it's becoming more and more important to do defacing. So if you take your typical 3D T1, you can always reconstruct without the hair and the beard and the mustache, but you can reconstruct the face and people can recognize it, machines can recognize it. So you need to do a type of defacing, but what you'll see is that the effect of this defacing differs between the able algorithms out there, and they can even take out too much. Yeah? So here you see that there's a part of the brain missing. And even importantly, if you look here on the first column, you see a Alzheimer patient, you see an MS patient with white matter lesions, and you see a tumor patient with a tumor lesion. And then we try to segment the gray matter, try to segment the white matter lesions, and try to segment the tumor. And this is without defacing, and this is after defacing. So you can see that the defacing actually can sort of confuse your post-processing pipeline. Because it, for example, thinks that the center of the mass should be lying here, and it sort of expects these extracranial image features. So we really need to pay attention to this. Going further to your segmentation, there are many segmentation types out there, and these are just three that are maybe the most similar. They're all SPM based. Which is intensity and template based, but already you can see that you can have quite some differences. This is the same subject with slight atrophy and with somewhat matter lesions. And this is the difference between the algorithms without and with filling, sort of correcting their white matter lesions. And you really have to sort of see what is most accurate here or what is most variable between your subjects. And so don't always look at the best algorithm, but also look at an algorithm that will perform sort of equally over your subjects, over your scanners, and maybe over time, as your scanner might be updated and the image contrast may change. One good thing to notice is that your typical MRI image is not always the best possible. And so as you can look at the cortex here, you see quite some nice contrast here. But in the subcortical regions, the contrast is usually not that good because it's a mix of gray and white matter tissue. And so there's a solution, and that's a sort of time-consuming MRI sequence where you can do T1 mapping and where you can actually segment these subcortical structures better. Or what some people do is they sort of enhance the spatial priors that you use for segmentation with sort of manually outlined subcortical structures. But what you see is if you use this template, that probably all of your segmentations will look the same for the subcortex. So there is just a lot of sort of signal mix between gray and white matter. And so some regions are more sort of sensitive to your processing than others. That's also good to keep into mind. Then the spatial normalization, when you put your images in a standard space, there are multiple ways to do that. You can do that in a sort of rigid body or almost sort of very low degrees of freedom way, where you just let the brain rotate and translate. And on average, it will be okay-ish. And for the tumor, because a normal template doesn't have a tumor, that might be the best way. But for the rest of the brain, in this case, the overlap will be much better if you use a nonlinear way, so more precise with more degrees of freedom. And so you have to sometimes balance between the techniques you use. And we turned out that if we would use a combined technique, so we would use the large degrees of freedom, the nonlinear registration technique in the healthy tissue, and then sort of morph into the low degrees of freedom and more affine rigid body registration for the tumor area, then you have a sort of compromise between the best of both worlds. Let me skip all these and go straight into the comparison of ASL with structure, which is sometimes called the partial volume effect. And this is obviously present in a lot of advanced MRI techniques that have a lower resolution than your typical T1. So in the case of ASL, that's 4x4x4 millimeters typically. But with ASL, because it has a reference with the 100 grams of brain tissue that you analyze, it can be very important. And there's a large contrast in perfusion between gray and white matter. And maybe this is in fMRI and DTI also important, because you're looking at one structure, either gray or white, matter more than the other. And if this would be equal between your patients and controls, you might not worry about this effect. But actually, if you look at this effect here, this is a row from a patient without atrophy, or maybe your healthy control, and this is a patient with atrophy. If you then don't do any partial volume correction, but you take the simplest way of partial volume correction, which is just defining an ROI of the whole gray matter in this case, and you say within the ASL resolution, so remember each voxel has to be 4x4x4, so that's 64 T1 voxels with a resolution of 1x1x1, then if you say I want to have at least 50% gray matter content in this 4x4x4 millimeter voxel, then this is the ROI that you will get. And if you want at least 70%, and which a lot of people do because you don't want to mix with the white matter signal, then you get this region of interest. But if you do the same with the patient, then you lose a lot of voxels because there is atrophy going on. So you don't only lose signal, because in this case, most of the signal to noise ratio is in your gray matter, but you also bias your analysis more so with patients than with control to regions where the gray matter is thick, which you can see here, the insula and also the putamen, and you lose other parts of the gray matter. And this, you usually don't look at this type of analysis. It's a good example to really look what is happening and where is my signal coming from. And here you see, this is interesting, here you see two images from the same vendor that uses a 3D spiral readout technique for ASL. And if you look at the left, this was the works in progress version, and it's, for me, it's the best ASL readout there is. And there's whole brain coverage, and the resolution is okay, and there's high signal to noise ratio as a 3D technique. But this is the same acquisition, but in the product version. What did they do? Well, they, for the product version, they wanted to smooth to get rid of ghosting artifacts. And for the clinician, it might be okay to have lower resolution where you can still see large perfusion changes. But for the researcher who wants to have good registration, we want to have this level of detail. So this is actually the same sequence, but with a Fermi filter in the acquisition reconstruction. And so it's very important to also keep in account what your acquisition reconstruction is doing, because these voxel sizes, nominally, the vendor tells you it's the same resolution, but this effective spatial resolution is much lower here, even though the voxel size that you will get out of the scanner is the same. I need to skip because my time is up, I see. I had some other interesting examples, but I hope that from these examples, the take-home message is clear that you have to check each processing step very clearly, both visually and quantitatively. Use your common sense. How can my processing affect the reproducibility and comparability between studies? And also look at, is there any correlation of image quality and processing quality, any interaction with physiology and pathophysiology? Okay, thank you very much.
Thanks so much for the talk. I think we can have a couple questions from the audience, if there's any. I think another reminder is that we are recording this session as well. And during the talks, feel free to put any questions you might have in the chat window. And I think the speakers can address them briefly after their talk. I think that currently we don't have any questions. So I will hand it to my co-moderator, Dr. Kim, for the next talk. Thank you.